Let me start by asking this question. How many of you sitting here today would like to take up a job that interests you with a starting salary of at least 1 lakh rupees per month? Quite a few. That's a fair representation of the number of people in this country seeking to opt for a job. A recent report by a reputed media company suggests that while there is a rise in number of individuals wanting to start on their own, still a large majority of the Indian students would want to opt for a job for stability-related reasons, and that is totally understandable. Irrespective of whichever stream of work that you're going to choose to work, be it banking or financial services, technology, or e-commerce, or manufacturing, it'd be good to know truly what differentiates the extraordinary people from the ordinary or the successful ones in the corporate setting. Over the years, extraordinary people, and learned from my own personal experiences, and I've come to realize that there are truly five contrasting behaviors that differentiate the extraordinary from the successful. First up, I'm going to talk to you about risk and stability. Well, it is obvious, isn't it? More risks, more rewards, we all know that. But why do most majority still settle for stability? Well, the answer is very, very simple. Risks are painful and are even often doubtful. And one starts to wonder when he's actually going through that phase of difficulty, whether it is even worth it. Let me share some of my own personal choices that I've made and the risks that I have taken. Well, I started out really, really small with practically nothing. My grandparents sent me away at the age of 8 to a boarding school. Came out of the boarding school, took my mom and sister out to the city, lived out of a very, very small 500 square foot flat, and taught some kids in the neighborhood to make the livelihood. Took out an education loan to finish my graduation. But in 2003, at the time of graduation, while most of my friends said that they would want to rather opt for a stable desk job, much against the wish and much against the advice of my friends, I chose the sales career. People said I was stupid. People said, you're going to really have to face a lot of humiliation. You're going to go out there every single day, make some 10 to 12 calls amidst rain, sun, traffic. But I chose it anyway. And I'm really glad that I made that choice, because year after year, I succeeded. I put my head down, went into that market every single day with a single-minded objective of making lives better of the people that I chose to work for. And then in 2013, I had to make another very, very tough choice. I had a very good job. I was then already the youngest regional business manager of a prominent company. Hunky-dory, great job. Everything was great. But then there came my way yet another opportunity to really make a difference in a newly integrated company. And for those of you who have managed integrations of companies, it's really difficult because you're talking about cultural issues, etc. And I had to take that job up, and a lot of advice came my way not to take it, because they said, you know, might as well wait. Why do you have to jump into fire? Because you know you're going to fail. But I made that choice anyways. And believe me, after seeing 10 years of amazing success, I failed, and I failed miserably. I failed so bad that I often at times choked up and wept in silence. But truly, that endurance that I've gone through really only matured me and made me more resilient as an individual. And that landed me up with a business unit head role for India and South Asia, and eventually took me to Harvard Business School. So I can vouch for it. Risks are painful or doubtful, but they pay real big. No pain, no gain, and risks will come with great rewards as well. Next up, attitude and aptitude. Most people rely on aptitude, the competencies that they would have picked up over a period of time. But the extraordinary ones truly rely on attitude. While there are dozens of definitions around attitude, I have my own personal definition of attitude. And that is a composition, a fine balance of four quotients: intelligence quotient, emotional quotient, spiritual quotient, and the last one, which is a physical quotient. IQ, let's talk about intelligence quotient. Mostly it is a genetic predisposition, isn't it? Either you have it or you don't, but truly What do you do with the intelligence that you already started out with? Do you constantly challenge yourself with something that you don't know or you've not done already? Have you sought out for a new role because careers are increasingly becoming jungle ladders? You just can't be developing expertise in one vertical and expect to grow. You just can't do that. What about PQ? Most people underestimate the physical quotient. They think you do your IQ and you balance your EQ fine. But the extraordinary ones truly focus on PQ as well. And what do I mean by physical quotient? A, fitness. B, personal grooming. Most people don't even pay attention to personal grooming. A little bit of effort to groom yourself well goes a long way. What about EQ? EQ for me, again, my definition is a combination of being, doing, and reflecting. Most people go out there wanting to talk. They do a lot, they be less, and they don't reflect at all. A potential extraordinary person strikes a fine balance between being, doing, and reflecting. Reflection, in my opinion, truly differentiates the immature from the mature. You go back every single day to introspect to see, where have you gone wrong? Can I change myself? Can I go back the next day and apologize to that individual who I have hurt, either consciously or unconsciously? And then spiritual quotient. Truly, do we question our own existence? Why do we even live in this world? Now, this questioning, this line of questioning, truly develops the moral fiber in the individual. So first up, people try to become good human beings. And if you are a good human being, you anyways are going to be a great, responsible corporate citizen. So great attitude is a composition of IQ, EQ, PQ, and SQ. None of them in no order of priority, truly, but all of them in combination and a fine balance between all the four Qs. Creating value and management. Truly, management is about managing the current day's performance, and creating value is the true difference between the gap between opportunity and current day's performance. The capital markets scream out loud for value creation every single day, but most people still look at the quarter end results and manage the share prices. They go for short-term behaviors. But the extraordinary ones block out all that noise and just stay focused between the gap between the opportunity and the current day's performance. Isn't it very, very clear? But most yet choose to just manage performance. Because value creation takes courage, takes a lot to block out the noise that there is, the pressure that there is to deliver short term. If you got to stay focused, if you stay focused on value creation, you will for sure deliver both short term as well as long term. People and business. Most don't understand. I come across two sets of people every single day. The first set of people who only stay focused on business, or you have your job and I have mine. Why don't you just deliver yours? The second set of people who would take that extra bit to walk out, to reach out to that individual or set of individuals and build personal relationships, personal connect, to make sure that they deliver what you want them to deliver. That's the biggest difference between people who truly believe in people versus people who just stay focused on business outcomes. They just don't understand that it is people who get the business and not the opposite. Last but not the least, constructing versus critiquing. You know, critiquing is great, but beyond a point, it slowly but surely, unconsciously builds into a habit, because critiquing gives a great high. We all want to be, you know, there's a critique in all of us. I fall prey to this very often because I get sucked into these conversations where everybody is talking about the bad things that there are, about the management, about the society. A lot of people spoke about being the change that you want to see, but how many of us do it? I fall prey to it so often. But the extraordinary ones know how to consciously block out that noise. I practice it every single day. Whenever I have to, you know, when I get running into these kind of conversations, I stay calm, I block myself out, go back and see what I can do to change it. And believe me, if one can reach out to the right person in the system with the right articulation, you know, things do happen. I'd like to say it's all about choices and consequences, really. I presented those five contrasting behaviors that truly differentiate the extraordinary ones from the successful ones. I, for one, don't promote extraordinariness. It's all about choices or consequences. What's right for you could be wrong for somebody else. What was right 100 years ago is not right anymore. Thank you very much.